Students, today we will start a new chapter, Thinkers, Belief and Building, Cultural Development, 600 BCE to 600 Common Era. So in this present chapter, our main objective is to throw light on the cultural development. Okay, during the period 600 BCE to 600 Common Era, we will study the cultural development. Okay. Of this period by knowing about the contemporary thinkers, beliefs and buildings. Our main focus in this chapter is on Buddhism and Sanchi Stup. We will also study some other contemporary traditions, because not only Buddhism but several other traditions also developed during this period. So the 6th century BCE was a period of the religious upheaval or agitations, not only in the Indian history but in the history of the whole world. It witnessed the emergence of the thinkers, okay, such as Zarathustra in Iran, Kongzi in China, and Socrates, Plato and Aristotle in Greece. Several religious ideas and the traditions, it emerged in the middle Gangetic plain, okay, in northern India, which ultimately took the shape of great intellectual and religious movement. So these religious traditions, okay, you can see, can be divided into two categories. The traditions that were openly against the Vedic religion, and you can see the tradition that did not oppose the Vedic religions, but you can see they propagate new principles venerating one or other old divinity. Okay, so when we talk about the Jainism and the Buddhism are the most prominent among the religious traditions or the faith that were against the Vedic religion. Vaishnavism and Shaivism came under this categories who propagate the new principles. So the real credit of making the religious and intellectual movement were wide and popular, it goes to the Jainism and Buddhism. Now comes the historical sources. So we use sources such as, you can see here, the Vedic, this Jain and Buddhist literature. When we talk about the literature, Vedic, Jain and Buddhist, building, inscriptions and sculpture. So now we talk about the Vedic literature. So the Vedas, the Brahmins, Upanishad, Sutra, Smriti, Puran, they fall under the Vedic literature. So the Veda are the most outstanding text of Vedic literature, and they are four in number: Rigved, Samved, Yajurved and Atharved. So Rigved is the most ancient of the Vedic literature. It helps us in understanding the religious, social, economic and political life of the ancient Aryans. So it gives information about Aryans. Okay, so Yajurved, Samved and Atharved, they throw on the life of the later Vedic Aryans who ruled around 1000 BC to 600 BC. Brahmins, it give an elaborate descriptions of Vedic rituals, and the Aranyak and the Upanishads throw light on the discourse on various spiritual and philosophical problems. Puran, you can see, significant and precious sources of ancient Indian history. when we talk about the number, the Purans are 18 in number. But of them, you can see Brahm, Vayu, Matsya, Vishnu, Bhagwat, Garud, Agni, Markandeya, etc. These are the particularly important for historical point of view. The Purans, it throws significant light on the political, social, economic and cultural conditions of the land from the earliest period to the Gupta period. Even it is the source, only source of getting information regarding the royal dynasties that came to power after the Mahabharat war till the 6th century AD. So it should be kept in mind that the Purans mainly concentrate on explaining Hindu religion and philosophy rather than the historical events or developments. So now we talk about the Buddhist literature. The earliest Buddhist texts were written in Pali. Okay, spoken in Magadha or South Bihar. So these texts, they tell us not only about the life of the Buddha, but also several rulers of the contemporary Magadha, Bihar and you can see Eastern Uttar Pradesh. So here you can see Tripitak, Sutpitak, Vinay and Abhidham Pitak. Okay, they are the earliest Buddhist texts. Buddha teachings, it are included in Sutpitak and Abhidham Pitak. And if you talk about Vinay Pitak, rules and regulation for joining the Sangha or monastic order, that is included in Vinay Pitak, especially the rules and regulation for Sangha. So the Jatak here, you can see, it tells us about the stories of the previous birth of Gautam Buddha. Here when we talk about the Jatak, which means story. So they throw significant light on the social and the economic condition of the period that is ranging from 5th to 2nd century BC. The Jatak also provide information about the political events in the age of Buddha. And when we, you can see, it provide the, information, okay, about the political event in the age of Buddha. And when we talk about the Sri Lankan text, here you can see Mahavansa and Deepavansa, okay. The historical text of Sri Lanka, it also throw light on the history of India during the 4th and the 5th century. Then come another text here, other text, Milindh Pano, which contain the philosophical discourse of the Greek king Menander and the Buddhist monk here Nagsen. They throw light on the life of the northwestern India during the period of 1st and 2nd century AD. And the texts like Divyadan, Arya, Manjushri, Moolkalp are also important from historical point of view. Even they also provide valuable informations regarding the social and cultural life of the ancient India. So we find mention of 16 Janpads in Anguttara Nikaya. When we talk about 16 Mahajanpads, we get information from Anguttara Nikaya, as we have already read. Here you can see, and the text like Lalit Vistar, Buddha Charitra and Mahavibhasha, it also provide some useful historical material. Now we talk about the Jaina literature. So like the Buddhist scholar, the Jaina scholar, they also produce significant literature in several languages such as Prakrit, Sanskrit and Tamil. So the manuscript of these texts, if you talk about the manuscript, they were carefully preserved in libraries attached to the temple for centuries. So the early Jain texts were written in Prakrit. They were finally compiled in वल्लभी इन गुजरात ड्यूरिंग 6th century AD, दे हेल्प सिग्निफिकेंटली इन द रिकंस्ट्रक्शन ऑफ द पॉलिटिकल हिस्ट्री ऑफ द ईस्टर्न उत्तर प्रदेश एंड बिहार ड्यूरिंग द एज ऑफ महावीर. सो हियर यू कैन सी ऑफ द जैन, यू कैन सी हियर द अगम्स. ओके, द 12 अंग्स वर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. दे ऑल्सो थ्रो लाइट ऑन द कंटेम्प्ररी पॉलिटिकल सोशल एंड इकोनॉमिक कंडीशन. बिसाइड प्रोवाइडिंग वैल्यूएबल इंफॉर्मेशन रिगार्डिंग महावीर स्वामी एंड जैनिज्म. एंड हियर वेन वी टॉक अबाउट भद्रबाहु चरित्र, ओके, टेल अस अबाउट द इवेंट ड्यूरिंग द रेन ऑफ चंद्रगुप्त मौर्य. वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टेक्स्ट लिटरेचर विच टेल अस गिव अस इन्फॉर्मेशन अबाउट चंद्रगुप्त मौर्य. एंड देन यू कैन सी हेमचंद्र प्रशस्ति पर्व. एंड हियर कम्स सम इम्पॉर्टेंट टेक्स्ट लाइक स्मारादित्य कथा. स्मारादित्य कथा, कथाकोश, कुवल्यमाला, आदि पुराण एंड उत्तर पुराण. दे वर ऑथर ड्यूरिंग द अर्ली मेडिएवल पीरियड. सो नाउ वी टॉक अबाउट द स्तूप, स्तूपा इंस्क्रिप्शन एंड श्राइन्स. यू कैन सी दे वर टू फर्निश सिग्निफिकेंट इन्फॉर्मेशन अबाउट जैनिज्म एंड बुद्धिज्म. सो हियर कम्स अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट सांची स्तूप. सो पीपल हैव बीन शोइंग अ पर्टिकुलर इंटरेस्ट इन द सैक्रेट प्लेसेस सिंस टाइम इमेमोरियल, ऑफन साइट विद स्पेशल वेजिटेशन, यूनिक रॉक्स ऑफ यू कैन सी और इंस्पायरिंग नेचुरल ब्यूटी डेवलप्ड इन टू सैक्रेट प्लेसेस. सो हियर कम्स अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट प्लेस. समटाइम दीज साइट्स विद स्मॉल स्टैंड अटैच टू दैम वर नोन एज चैत्य. सो हियर कम्स अ प्लेस दैट इज एसोसिएटेड विद द लाइफ एंड द एक्टिविटी दैट ग्रो इन टू सेक्रेट प्लेसेस विच आर एसोसिएटेड विद द एक्टिविटी ऑफ बुद्धा. सो हियर यू कैन टेक एन एग्जाम्पल दैट लुम्बिनी वेयर द बुद्धा इट अ प्लेस इट इज एसोसिएटेड विद एक्टिविटी. एक्टिविटी हियर इज द बर्थ ऑफ बुद्धा, बुद्धा बॉर्न. एंड देन यू कैन सी वेयर बोध गया वेयर ही अटेन एनलाइटमेंट. सारनाथ हिज फर्स्ट वेयर ही डिलीवर्ड हिज फर्स्ट सर्मन और स्पीच. एंड देन खुशीनगर वेयर ही अटेन निर्वाण. It came to be regarded as sacred places of Buddhism. So here comes stup, a Sanskrit word which means heap or mound. Okay, it was built over the sacred relics. Relics here are the remains, relics of Buddha and sacred monks. So relics here are the remains of the Buddha, like tooth, ashes, bhasma. Either of the Buddha himself or of a sacred monk or a sacred text. So these remains, they were generally placed in a box in a smaller chamber in the center of the base of the stupa or stoop. So the stoop were often built with a donation here that is made for building them the king such as the Satvahanas. Okay. And you can see the wealthy person, guild of the merchant and the artisans. And even monks and nuns made donation for building the stoop or stupa. Donation, here we find records of donations. Okay, record of donations that were made for building and decorating the stoop on the railing and the pillar of the stoop. So the inscriptions also mention the name of the donor. Here you can see the inscription maintain the name of the donor, sometimes the name of the place from where they came, their occupation, name of the relative as well. One of the gateway at Sanchi built with the money donated by the guild of ivory workers of Vidisha. So when we talk of the stupa, here you can see a hemi spherical dome. Okay, it was built on a low circular base and it is known as ant. Above the ant there was another structure that we called harmika. Okay, The Harmika was a balcony like structure. It was considered to be the seat of God. There was a mast, again it called Yashti, arising from the Harmika. Okay, and if it are the mast at the top here, you can see a pole that we call Yashti. And at the top of the Yashti, there is a it was surmounted by a chhatri or the umbrella known as Chhatravali. So in order to separate the sacred places from the secular world, you can see a railing was built around the mound. A railing was built around the mound. So the stoop like that of Sanchi and Amravati were discovered unintentionally. Okay, the stoop at Sanchi located in Bhopal. So Sanchi stoop that is located in Bhopal is considered of much significant from historical point of view. So here you can see that we find it mentioned also in Mahavansh and Deepvansh, the historical text of Sri Lanka. One day in the summer of 1818, you can see British Army General Taylor. Okay, he reached the top of a hillock in the village named Sanchi. He found there a unique mound. We talk about the mound resembling a dome. In 1822, Captain Johnson, assistant political agent in the state of Bhopal, got a part of the mound excavated. So in 1851, you can see Alexander Cunningham got further excavation work carefully. It has been mentioned in Taj-ul-Iqbal Tariq Bhopal. As such, the most wonderful building in the state of Bhopal are at Sanchi, Kankhera, a small village under the brow of a hill some 20 miles northeast of the Bhopal, which we visited yesterday. We inspected the stone sculpture, the statue of the Buddha and an ancient gateway. The ruin appeared to be an object of great interest to European gentlemen. Major, you can see here, Alexander Cunningham stayed several weeks in his neighborhood and examined this ruin very carefully. He took drawing of the place, deciphered the inscriptions and bore shaft down these dome. So in here you can see in 1881, H.S. Coley, an archaeologist, got cleared of the forest. Okay, cleared the forest on its hillock in order to preserve the remain of the Sanchi stoop. In 1912, you can see John Marshall, Director General of Archaeological Survey of India, got further the excavation work at Sanchi. So an effort was made to bring the stoop of Sanchi in its original form by putting together different part of its ruin. So the European, they were much attracted, okay, for the Sanchi stoop in the 19th century. So in 1818, when the stoop at Sanchi was discovered, three of its gateway was still standing at the site. The fourth gateway was found lying there, and if you talk about the mound too, was in a good condition. So at the time it was suggested this gateway be sent to London or Paris. Fortunately, it could not be done so owing to certain reasons, otherwise we would have been deprived of our so rich in heritage. So the French were specially interested in the gateway of the Sanchi stoop. So they wanted to exhibit in the French Museum the eastern gateway of stoop, which was the in the best condition of them all. So they sought permissions of Shah Jahan Begum, the ruler of Bhopal, to carry it to France. Some Englishmen too wanted to carry it to England. Fortunately, both the French and the Englishmen came to be satisfied with carefully prepared plaster cast copies of the gateway, and thus the original structure, it remained at its original site at Sanchi. So this Shah Jahan Begum and the successor Sultan Jahan Begum, okay, the ruler of Bhopal, made a remarkable contribution in the preservation of the Sanchi stoop. It was the reason that John Marshall, he dedicated his important volume on Sanchi to Sultan Jahan Begum. Jahan Begum not only provided money for the preservation, of the stupa, but also got constructed there a museum and a gateway. So you can see, while staying in this guest house, John Marshall authored important volumes, the publication of which was also funded by Sultan Jahan Begum. So now come the sculpture at Sanchi. So generally, on looking at the sculpture or the panel slab at Sanchi, it become quite difficult to guess as into in what context they were depicted, or so what they really meant. The Buddhist texts help us significantly to understand the sculpture at Sanchi. So here you can see that a part of the northern gateway, of the Sanchi stupa, we find it in the thatched hut, trees, men, women and children, which make us assume that it depicts some ruler scene. However, the art historian who had deeply studied the sculpture at Sanchi concluded that a scene here, it was from the Vasantara Jata, has been depicted in the piece of the sculpture. So scene has been taken from the Vasantara Jata. So in Vasantara Jata, you can see there is a mention of a generous prince who gave away everything that belonged to him to Brahmins in charity and went to live in the forest along with his wife and children. So it became clear that the scholar often tried to understand the meaning of the sculpture with the help of the concerned text and interpreted by it, comparing it with the textual evidences. So here you can see several sculptures at Sanchi. They did not get any direct inspiration, from the Buddhist idea. These sculptures were depicted under the influence of the popular traditions. For example, you can see the sculpture of beautiful women have been depicted on the gateway of the Sanchi stupa. They have been depicted swinging, holding onto the branches of a tree at the edge of the gateway. The historian, suggested that the motifs or the symbols depicted in the sculpture at Sanchi were also taken from the popular traditions. So beautiful and lively figures of the animals have been depicted at Sanchi. The figures are normally those of the elephants, horses, monkey and cattle. Several scenes depicted at Sanchi are related to the story of the animals that described in the Jata. So according to some scholars, these animals were perhaps depicted in order to attract the visitors by lively scenes. We should remember that often animals were used to symbolize the human attributes. The elephant was regarded as a symbol of strength and wisdom, and of these motifs or symbols, a figure of woman surrounded by lotuses and elephant deserves special mentions. So the elephant here had been depicted sprinkling water on the woman as it performing abhishek. Some historians identified this sculpture with Maya, mother of Buddha, whereas some other identify it with Gaj Lakshmi, the goddess of good fortune. As you can see here, the elephant, it depicted elephant sprinkle the water on the woman and it perform abhishek or consecrations. Even some historians, they identified the sculptures with Maya, mother of the Buddha, whereas some identified it with the Gaj Lakshmi, the goddess of the good fortune.